Guys, what are we even doing here? Who are we kidding? Maybe you all can keep lying to yourselves, but I just can't. I can't keep pretending, looking the other way. I just need to come out and say it. 3D printed text sucks, and I'm sick of pretending that it doesn't. In the best case scenario, you're 3D printing on the top or bottom layer, leaving you with a few options, none of them good. You can switch colors on that layer and hope the text is big and clear enough to not blend together. You can add additional layers either in the same color or a different color, which look better, but leave you with a not flat surface that isn't pleasant to touch and can get caught on things. Or you can inset the text with a color change, which becomes a magnet for dirt and debris, and it's harder to read. And it wastes filament by requiring you to add lots of top layers. Actually, all of these options waste filament because of color changes. In the worst case scenario, you want to add text or logos to another face of the print, particularly if it's a curved face, which, while very easy to do in most modern slicers, requires costly, wasteful, and extremely slow color changes on anything but the most expensive tool changer 3D printers. None of those cons would be so bad, though, if the end product really looked good. But in my mind, it just doesn't. Like, don't get me wrong, for your own fun projects or your Gridfinity bins or even your functional purposes, yeah, 3D printed text or logos embossed or even debossed onto your designs are fine. They do the job. But if you're part of the growing economy of people actually selling your 3D printed products, you probably don't want to deal with color changes at scale. And what's more, the end product just doesn't look professional, doesn't look polished. This, I think, is why even companies like Prusa, who've historically and very proudly relied on 3D printing so heavily, are now even themselves using things like UV printing to make their products more polished and consumer grade. Or why some maker brands like AnchorMake are reportedly developing consumer and prosumer grade UV printers to democratize that technology. But it's not here yet. So in this video, I wanted to explore what I think might be another alternative or series of alternatives for labeling, branding, or personalizing your 3D prints, either for your own uses around the house or shop, or to drive up the perceived value and desirability of the products that you may sell online. I wanted to understand and compare the different options available to me for adding crisp, professional-looking logos or text to my 3D printed projects, ranging from fully 3D printed varieties that I mentioned earlier, to different types of laser etching and engraving, to even creating tasteful add-ons such as wood, leather, or metal for that truly luxurious end product. Along the way, I did a lot of testing, including multiple different types of lasers, frequencies, intensities, and more. And throughout this video, I'll be sharing my results so that you can skip straight to the best results if you try to do this yourself. Fortunately for me, Laserpecker, I know, funny name, but seriously slick product, agreed to sponsor this video as well as send over their fully loaded LP5 bundle, complete with portable laser, air purifier, materials kit, rotary add-on, and more, all so that I could really comprehensively test everything that I wanted to. This laser is kind of the perfect tool for what I want to achieve here because A, it's portable, so even if my project is too big to fit under the work area, I can just press the laser onto it. B, it features both diode and fiber lasers, so I can engrave, cut, or etch literally any type of plastic in addition to steel, leather, wood, acrylic, brass, you name it. And C, it comes with a rotary module, so I can even work on irregular or round shapes. And D, it has an air purifier, so I can do all of the above without dying, which is always nice. So I feel like I already covered a lot of the cons of 3D printed text, but real quick, I do want to look at some more examples just to get a baseline for both the quality of the outcome as well as the costs in terms of time and material. As I said before, you almost have to break 3D printed text into two different subcategories, depending on whether you need the text on the top or bottom layers or on the actual body of the print, because they really are a different animal. The former is sometimes passable, especially if you use the right build plate and nozzle size, and can even offer a wide range of options such as colors that you just can't get with the other options that we're going to explore. But again, to quickly reiterate the downsides, as you're seeing on the screen, Doing this adds time, it adds material cost, complexity, and also it sometimes doesn't come out on a smooth build plate either. Not to mention, it requires you to use a 0.4 millimeter nozzle or smaller most of the time, and it really works best with a wasteful multi-material system or a very expensive tool changer. And those problems are, of course, compounded if you need the text on the body of the print. Just look at how much time and material are wasted with purge, and even still, the end product has seams wherever those colors meet. Yes, you could do the text without color changes, but then it's not nearly as visible or as appealing. All right, now let's switch to the kind of meat and potatoes of this video, which is laser engraving. As you may know, there are a number of different technologies out there when it comes to lasers, each with their own pros and cons. And I know you guys typically don't really care about lasers, but before I show you what they can do or cannot do to our 3D prints, I do want to give a quick crash course on the different types available, and I'll try to keep it as short and informative as possible, I promise. First, you have CO2 lasers, which can cut a very wide range of materials, including wood, plastics, clear materials such as acrylic, and more. But they are typically quite costly. These operate at around the 10.6 micrometer wavelength, which means that they cannot cut or engrave metals without a special marking spray. Next, you also have diode lasers, which is what the plethora of cheap, dangerous, and open lasers that flood the market these days are typically powered by. Now, these can engrave or even cut wood, leather, plastics, or painted materials, but because they operate at 450 nanometers, they're really quite useless for things like glass, acrylic, or metals. And finally, we have the big dog, and quite frankly, the main reason I accepted this machine, fiber lasers. These guys operate at a wavelength of 1,064 newton meters, and they're the ones that you might have seen in those super addictive shorts or videos, flicking around on an object like a penny and cleaning it or etching it. And yes, depending on the power, these can literally engrave or cut into all sorts of metals, as well as plastics, ceramics, and much more. They can even cut thin metals, films, or foils, though they aren't as useful for cutting organic materials like wood or leather, which I guess is why, despite diode lasers being considered somewhat cheap and more hobbyist class, this laser that we're talking about today does include one. Now that you're a little bit more educated on the different types of lasers, let me share with you my process for testing in this video. Now, I'll spare you all the gory details, but I spent the better part of 3 days printing and blasting these useful little filament chips to tweak the absolute best settings. Obviously, different lasers with higher or lower power will have slightly different settings, but at the very least, these will provide a useful starting point for all of you. And my hope is that you can skip straight to the right wavelength and time and just vary the intensity if your laser is more or less powerful than my laser. I'll also make a spreadsheet of all of these different optimal settings and share that with my Patreon and YouTube channel members, so don't worry about trying to remember all this or taking notes. Also, before we get to the actual numbers and specs, I do need to give a little bit about my actual process for testing. Because I came into this a relative laser novice, I had no idea which characteristics would influence the final product. For example, would ABS behave differently than PLA due to the different chemical properties of the material? Which type of laser would work best for which type of color? And most importantly, for 3D printing, where we 3D print hollow parts with a shell as thin as 0.8 millimeters, would different wavelengths cause the material to actually melt through the thinnest part of the sample, causing a hole or even deformation in the surface? After all, one of the reasons I want to try this is as an alternative to wasteful multi-material printing, and it would kind of completely defeat the purpose if I need to make all my walls thicker to accommodate this process. Okay, I'm cognizant of the fact that we're like 10 minutes into the video and I haven't shared any actual results, but background is important, okay? Anyways, here's what I learned. First of all, diode lasers are, as somewhat expected, a non-starter on most plastics. Most of the time, they didn't leave a mark, and when I pushed it and tried to force them, they did more damage than good. Second, and most interestingly, material type doesn't really matter. I really expected, say, TPU to behave very differently than PLA or ABS, but in all my testing, I found that most plastics, at least the types that we regularly 3D print, and ones without additives like carbon fiber, behaved pretty similarly. But the third point is a big one. color makes all the difference. This is pretty obvious in retrospect, I guess. I mean, we're dealing with light, wavelengths, and of course, absorption of that light. On the whole then, lighter colored filaments required higher levels of intensity to leave a clearly legible mark. Again, it makes sense. The more pigment there is in the filament, the easier the light is absorbed, causing that burning effect that we're looking for. But there are still some surprising things that I didn't expect. First, no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get the in-between filaments, such as orange or blue, to etch in the opposite color. White filament burned into black text. Black filament burned into gray or white text. And everything else, purple, blue, green, it all went one of two ways. What I mean is, no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get this sample of light green filament to burn to black text, nor could I get this dark orange to burn into white text. Repeated attempts to kind of force it would just yield an ugly in-between, like a burnt brown, which I did find interesting. And that leads us to the final learning, at least as far as laser etching directly onto the 3D print goes. Transparency matters a lot. Now, if you are a HueForge enthusiast and are therefore used to thinking about or testing what they call transmission distance, this won't come as a surprise to you. But if you usually print reasonably thick-walled objects and therefore aren't too bothered with just how opaque or not opaque that roll of white filament is, then this is worth paying attention to. Different filaments, naturally, have different levels of opacity or transmission distance. And that, pretty obviously, directs how much light it can absorb. So this, in turn, affects both the intensity required to etch them and the success of the best possible result. Try as I may, this particular shade of white PLA just did not want to go any darker than this without muddying or burning it. And the same goes for this semi-translucent orange. In fact, there were even some materials that I literally wasn't able to get an acceptable end result with at all. Now, to give you the cheat code that I promised earlier, here are the winners of all my different tested settings. And for each sample, you will see on the chip the material type, the wavelength, the laser intensity, the engraving depth, which is another way of saying the speed, the number of passes, and the frequency of the laser. For the most part, everything is the same except for the intensity and depth. And this might seem like a bunch of boring stats on the screen, so feel free to skip to the next chapter if you want. But I do think it will be interesting for you to kind of watch and observe how the color and opacity of each material impacts these two parameters in somewhat surprising ways. Like, are teal and purple really that different? Okay, here we go. So the lesson here is pretty clear. And honestly, I'm sure you would have done this beforehand, but if you are considering using lasers to etch your 3D prints, especially at scale, test the material first. You might think that you're safe with that same white PLA or orange PLA that you always use, but different colors will behave vastly differently under the laser. And if you're running a business, for example, you really don't want to buy a pallet of that material, only to discover that it is more transparent than you ever realized. Now, I don't want this video to get too long, but I do think that it would be a mistake to not mention the third option for actually adding text, logos, branding, or any kind of customization to your 3D prints. And that is inserts, plaques, and accents. Part of the inspiration for this video actually came from watching my friend, the Swedish maker, who has recently been adding some absolutely gorgeous inserts to some of his projects to really make them shine. So I thought to myself, let's experiment with different media and see what we come up with. Obviously, wood, leather, acrylic, and metal are all cheap, readily available, and they're easy to work with. Though please do be careful of fumes because each of these materials can have adhesives or chemicals that are used in the manufacturing process and can therefore be extremely dangerous for you if burned and inhaled. So always, always, always with a laser, work in a well-ventilated area, use proper air filtration, and use materials that are specifically intended for laser cutting. Again, because the Laserpecker LP5 has both a diode and a fiber laser, there really actually isn't a medium that you can't engrave with it. So I think it's time for a little maker montage. Obviously, adding these inserts is an extra step in your process, but I would argue that if properly designed, it doesn't take much more work than just customizing your products right in the slicer. And, I mean, look at the results. Compare the look of these projects to the 3D printed text that we started with. The difference is night and day. The only thing is, this upleveling won't come cheap. Fiber lasers are still very much a professional or prosumer tool, and the Laserpecker LP5 will set you back about $3,000, or $37.99 for the bundle that I used throughout this video. So is the average garage or hobbyist going to be purchasing that just for personalizing their own wooden spoons or 3D prints at home? Probably not. But if you're running a 3D printing business and want to either expand your product line or level up your products so that they command a higher price, I honestly can't think of a better way to do it. If you're interested in the Laserpecker LP5 or any of Laserpecker's products, I'll leave a link in the description. And thanks to Laserpecker for sponsoring this video and sending over this machine so that I would have the opportunity to do all this experimentation and share my results with all of you. That's all for this week, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.